Out. Just to set the scene of what what's going to happen here today. We want each and every one of you to encounter a living God. And we're going to do that. We're going to have a few more songs of worship. We're going to have an opportunity for each and every one of us to receive prayer. And then we're going to hear a powerful message from the Word of God. Amen? Before we continue to worship, I want to remind us this. Is that Jesus Christ is risen. That the tomb is empty. And because of His grace and mercy, we get to walk out of our very own graves into a life of eternity with Him. I'm telling you today that this is the reason why we worship. This is the reason why we lift up the name that is above every name. So will you join me as we lift up our risen Savior, Jesus Christ?
Come on, let's all sing this out. Here we go.
And if you walked in sick, you're gonna walk out healed. If you walked in bound, you're gonna walk out free. 'Cause just the mention of His name, and just the mention of His name, and just the mention of His name, and everything can change.
Come on, somebody say this with me.
And if you walked in heavy, you're gonna walk out light. If you walked in weary, you're gonna be alright. Just the mention of His name. Just the mention of His name. Just the mention of His name. And everything can change. Everything can change. If you walked in.
Oh, Jesus was crucified on that cross. He was laid in a tomb. It would be sealed. And early Sunday morning, while it was still dark, this lady named Mary Magdalene would come to the tomb. And she would find this tomb empty and her Jesus was gone. You got to know a little bit about Mary. This isn't Mary, mother of Jesus. This is Mary Magdalene. She had a past. She had a reputation. In Luke 8, you would actually read about Mary Magdalene. She was the woman, the crazy woman, who was possessed by 7 demons. She was in bondage, enchained. And Jesus set her free. So she's the first to arrive at the tomb, and she doesn't know what we already know. She didn't get the spoiler alert. She didn't know what happened to her Jesus, the one who emancipated her and set her free. And so she's distraught, and rightfully so. She's grieving. She's at a loss. She's in deep emotional pain. I'm sure she felt disappointment. And it says in John 20, verse 14, it says, Mary turned to leave the empty tomb and saw someone standing there. And it was Jesus, but she didn't recognize him. She actually talked to this guy for a while and thought she was talking to the gardener. This Jesus who set her free, she didn't recognize him. Why is this part of the story so important for you and I? Because I think there are many of us in this room today that whether we're in it or we've gone through seasons of emotional pain, of grief, of loss, of disappointment and struggles, we too have been like Mary Magdalene and have failed to recognize that even in our deepest pain and our deepest regrets and our deepest worries, that we failed to realize Jesus was standing right beside us too. Now listen to what happened. Verse 16, Jesus said, Mary. He called her by name, and Mary turned to Jesus and cried out, Lord. Here's the two things I want you to hear today. Number one, Jesus knows your name. He knows your name. And I know that all the believers in here know that, and that's why they're clapping. But there's some people in here today that you are anonymous in this place, and you're like, nobody in here knows my name. In fact, I don't want anyone to know my name. I'm sneaking in. And I'm letting you know, even if no one in here ever knows your name, although we hope to do, there is one who knows you. He sees you where you're at right now. He doesn't just know your name. He knows every detail of your life. Says that you were formed in the innermost parts of your mother's womb. He knows every hair upon your head, but he doesn't stop there. He knows what you carried in today. He knows every struggle that you are struggling with. He knows the pain, the emotional pain. Some of you are carrying deep relational pain, financial hardships, the things that are concerning you, that are keeping you up at night, the big decisions that you've got to make, that you're not sure exactly what to do. He knows exactly what you are doing and where you are at, and he wants you to know he is right beside you, even if you don't recognize that he is. Doesn't negate the fact that he's still there. He's right beside you. And the second thing that I want you to know is, just like Mary, as she turned toward Jesus, everything changed. And the same will be for you as well. When you and I turn toward Jesus, he changes everything. I promise you, his hope will not disappoint. Every Sunday, we pause in the middle of our worship so anyone and everyone who has need, and who doesn't, right? Like, we all have needs. But we want to join our faith with yours. There's something so precious and powerful when we step out of our seats and we come forward, whether it's in the front to our prayer partners up here or in the balcony, and we just say, I need prayer. Sometimes it's specific. Sometimes it's for health issues or for relationship issues or for financial issues, physical healing, emotional, mental healing. He heals it all. He does it all. He cares about it all. If it concerns you, friends, it concerns him. He sees you, he knows you, and he cares about what concerns you. And so we're going to give you an opportunity, whether it's your first time here, and I know that may feel weird, but this is just normal for us here at Grace. We turn to Jesus. We turn to Jesus. Every day and every Sunday, we do this so that anyone and everyone can receive prayer. So we're going to continue to worship. Please remain standing so anyone who would like to come forward for prayer could easily slip out. Don't hesitate in coming down. God bless you as you come.
Nothing. Resurrection Sunday, everybody. Come on, rain or shine, you made it today. Proud of you. Just want you to know, if you haven't figured it out yet, we kind of make a big deal about Jesus here at Grace. He's kind of our main thing. In fact, just so you know, he's our everything. And maybe you feel uncomfortable today. Maybe you're not familiar with church, or you're sitting next to someone that's a bit crazy, kind of sweaty during worship. Like, what's up with this crazy? You just need to know, we really believe that our Savior died on a cross for our sins. They put him in a tomb. It could not hold him. On the third day, he got up out of the grave. He lives forevermore. And it's not just because it's some philosophy or theory or doctrine that we adhere to. It's you're surrounded with people today that have experienced the power of the risen King in their life. Somebody that's been changed. You might be standing next to someone that has been set free, and God healed their marriage, set them free from drugs or addiction, and you don't know the story of crazy that God brought that person out of. And I know we come out of the gate kind of heavy and loud, but you just need to know we are not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is the power of God unto salvation. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15, he said, if Christ did not come out of the grave, if he's not risen, he said, we have nothing to preach about. I've got no message for you if Jesus is not alive. He said, your faith is empty, your hope is hollow. In fact, he says, your faith is so futile because we're stuck in our sins if Christ is not risen. He says, actually, we of all people are the most to be pitied if Christ stayed in the tomb. But he is alive, and we have much to celebrate today. Can we just, 60 more seconds, can we lift our voices once again? Give God praise. Fill this place with worship today. Lift your hands, lift your hearts to heaven. God, you're worthy. You're worthy. All praise, all glory to you, King Jesus. You live forevermore. Online, Lord, invade that space right now with the reality of who you are. Lord, we thank you for everything that you've done for us today. We celebrate you in this house in the wonderful, almighty name of Jesus. Everybody said amen. 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 Hey, why don't you do this? We call this forced fellowship at Grace. It's good for you. Why don't you just find about two or three people in your proximity, slap them a high five and say, my King's alive. Come on, declare that today. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive.
Students, if you are in 6th, 7th, or 8th grade and sitting in our 9 a.m. service, you are invited to leave service right now and head to the conference room for our Middle School Connect group. We are going to have a great time and look forward to connecting with you.
Ladies, we can't wait to see you all again for our next Honey Huddle on Friday, April 19th. This night is tailor-made for gals in high school all the way to the golden age honeys. Come ready for an evening of sweet fun, yummy treats, powerful worship, and building community with other honeys of grace. And this is a perfect evening to bring your friends to. Register online for free today and reserve your spot for childcare. We can't wait to see you there. Good morning and welcome to Grace Church. If this is your first time with us, we are so glad you are here and we want to connect with you. Text Grace Guest to 97000 or fill out a communication card located in the seat pocket in front of you. Just drop it in the wall boxes at the end of service. The best way to stay up to date is to download our church app. Just search for Grace Church Oceanside in your app store and you will find us. While you're doing that, here are a few things happening at Grace.
Lunch with the Pastors is next Sunday. This brief lunch will help you get plugged into the life and ministry of our church and help you get connected. Join us Sunday, April 7th at 12:30 p.m. in the conference room located next to the cafe. Childcare and lunch will be provided for your kids as well. No sign up is necessary.
Grace Youth, our junior and senior high student ministry, gathers together every Sunday to pursue the presence of God, grow in friendships, and have lots of fun. We have so many exciting things happening in Grace Youth, and we want every student at Grace to be a part.
Grace Kids is available every Sunday for ages 0 to 5th grade. If you prefer to keep your little ones with you and they get fussy or excited during the service, feel free to take advantage of our family room, located just outside the East Sanctuary doors near the cafe. It includes a live stream of our service and is available for you to relax while still staying connected with the message. If you have any questions or need help locating it, see one of our greeters or ushers and they will direct you.
Giving has never been easier. You can drop your envelope into the wall boxes around the church, or you can give online at gracesd.tv, use the Grace Oceanside app, or text GRACESD to 77977 for a secure and easy way to give. To find out what your next steps are in your relationship with Christ, stop by our Following Jesus tables on your way out to receive a free gift and Bible from us. Or text Amazing Grace to 97000 or download our Grace Church app and follow us on social media at Grace North County. We look forward to seeing you next Sunday, and be sure to bring someone with you.
How can your stripes, my healing, all praise, King Jesus. Glory to God in heaven, your blood is still speaking, your love is still reaching, all praise, King Jesus. Glory to God forever, your cross, my freedom, your stripes, my healing, all praise, King Jesus. Glory to God in heaven, your blood is still speaking, your love is still reaching, all praise, King Jesus. Glory to God.
The women at the tomb, the shaking ground, the stone removed. This is Easter. The flash of lightning, the angel's testimony, the promise of Jesus, the empty grave. This is Easter. A day to hope against all odds. A day to worship our living God. A day to believe in the power of Jesus. A day to celebrate and a day to remember. The curse is broken. The promise is true. The tomb is empty. The King is alive. This is Easter.
Amen. Come on, it's good to be in church on Easter Sunday, isn't it? Easter, resurrection, I don't care what you call it as long as you realize what this is about. People trying to put all kinds of labels on this day, but it's about Jesus. You need to know that. I love our balcony people up there. Can we put our hands together for those up in the high rise? We call you the more spiritual people because you're up there by heaven. We love you up there in the nosebleeds. I see you. I see you way up there trying to hide. I got you. I told Sabrina, I leaned over, I said, I feel like my heart's about to explode. I love Resurrection Sunday. It's like the best Sunday to come to church as we celebrate together because it's for Christians and believers around the world, the Super Bowl of all gatherings, to celebrate what is most important. The crux of all of our doctrines, theologies, and beliefs hang and hinge upon the fact that Jesus got up out of that grave. It matters and means everything that the tomb is empty because he lives like she so beautifully sang like only she can. I tried to sing like that. They wouldn't let me sing that solo today. I tried. But is the truth. Today I want to take you to the Gospel of John, chapter 20. If you have your Bibles, you can make your way there if you'd like to track along. If you don't have your Bible, they'll get it up on the Jumbotron in a minute. But just out of curiosity, I need to know today, are there any runners in the house? Show of hands if you like to run. Just put them up high. And a few of you, we're a fit church here at Grace. Runners, I need you to know, I love you runners, I just don't understand you. I can't prove this theologically, but I think there will be running in hell. I just think that cats and DMVs and hell, they're gonna running all together. That's my opinion. But I do respect you because I find running torture. You like find it therapeutic and you enjoy to do it. Nobody makes you do it. I've said this before and I'll say it again. If you ever see me running, you might want to run too because somebody or something's chasing us. Hello. But just so I know who my audience is here today, are there any people that have ever ran a marathon? Any marathon runners? My goodness, just hold your hands up and look around. These people are the real deal. Any up in the balcony? I saw a couple of hands. Marathons. Like, I don't care if your marathon was like 18 hours. The fact that you ran 26.2 miles is phenomenal. Like, you chose to run 26. I don't want to drive 26.2 miles. You chose to do that. I want to talk today in our few moments together about some of the biggest running events in human history. A few years ago, there was actually an experiment done to see if a human being could run a marathon in under 2 hours. It had been considered to be absolutely impossible. No human being would ever be able to run 26.2 miles in under 2 hours. So in 2019, they set up and manufactured a marathon in Vienna, Austria, and they brought in a legendary marathoner, a Kenyan named Eliud Kipchoge, and he set out to run a sub 2 hour marathon. And the crazy thing is, he did it. He finished the marathon just in the nick of time at 1 hour 59.4 seconds. Actually, let me tell you, 1 hour 59 minutes and 40 seconds. Meaning he held, this just to put this into perspective, he held a pace of 4-minute 34-second miles for 26.2 miles. But it didn't count. They refused to consider that an official world record because he did not adhere to sanctioned rules. And the standard competition rules for pacing and fluids were not properly followed. Because it was a course that was designed specifically for Kipchoge, and it was designed to be very flat as possible, with as few twists and turns as possible. In fact, they hired a group of 30 elite runners to surround him. And these runners would surround him. A car would set the pace in front of them. I think we have a picture of this, actually. You can see that even technology was used. This green laser was broadcast on the concrete. They had to keep their feet on the green in order to ensure a record-breaking pace. He didn't even have to veer over to the side table to grab water. Someone on a motorcycle would come alongside of him. It was set up for him to break a record. In the middle of this pack, they would be breaking the headwind so he could draft behind them. But it didn't count. Now, if I'm Eliud Kipchoge, I don't care what you say, I'm putting a plaque on my wall that I broke the 2 hour barrier. Say what you want, it got done. Now, lest you think he's a slouch or somehow cheated, he actually did hold the world record for the marathon at an ever so slow pace of 2 hours, 1 minute and 9 seconds. He held that record until 2023, when another Kenyan, apparently they run fast in Kenya. I tried racing my son from our office to the upper parking lot last week. I just want you to know, I beat him. I did. I beat him. I'm 47 years old. I beat him, but I was feeling pains in my body for the next week. But in Kenya, they know how to run. Another Kenyan named Kelvin Kiptum broke the record, finishing at 2 hours and 35 seconds. How many think that's going to be broken someday? That's like it's on its way. Some of you need to get busy. Let's make that happen. So there's a few marathon runners. Anybody show hands you've ever ran a mile? Where are my mile runners at? Okay, now we're talking to the right people. That mean junior high PE coach made you run that grueling mile. A little more relatable. Talking about big running events in history. In 1954, another big running event happened in Oxford, England, when a man by the name of Roger Bannister, have you heard of him? Roger Bannister broke the 4-minute mile. Again, another barrier that was considered humanly impossible. They said no one could ever run a mile sub 4 minutes. And yet he did it. He was the first to do it. Again, barely. He ran it in 3 minutes, 59.4 seconds. And what was crazy, there's this phenomenon that happened once people realized it could be broken, this record that had not been broken ever, once they realized it could, he only held that record for a short time and it was repeatedly and rapidly broken by so many people once they realized it was actually possible. Now I had to go back to see, okay, who holds the record now? Currently, just so you know, because I know you're wondering, the current world record for the mile is held by a man from Morocco named Hicham El Guerrero, and he ran it in 3 minutes, 43.13 seconds. But what's crazy, he's held that record since 1999. That is so unusual in this sport. 25 years. Come on, somebody needs to break that record now too. So we're talking about big running events in history. I was doing some research. I had to look way back on another big running event. I want to tell you about another event that took place. It's called the Easter Morning 1,000 Meter Race. This one happened a while back in 33 AD in the city of Jerusalem, when the news of an empty tomb got back to the disciples of Jesus who were still locked up and held up in their doubt, disillusionment, and discouragement. They got wind of the empty tomb and the resurrected Savior, King Jesus, and their hearts were so stirred that they began to run. You need to understand today that this news of the empty tomb will cause you to start running. It will elicit excitement. It should move you into action. You say, I'm not a runner. It doesn't matter. These disciples started running when they got the news that we're hearing about today. Anybody grow up in a church where they would get so crazy they'd start taking laps? Don't do that today. John's gospel tells us about this Easter morning, 1,000 meter dash. In John 20, verse 1, look at this story with me. Early on the first day of the week, this is after the cross, after the tomb. People are hopeless and discouraged. Early on that first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came, look at this, she came. Everybody say it out loud, she came. She came running. She ran to Simon Peter and the other disciples, or the other disciple, the one Jesus loved. Just time out for a minute. I love this. John's writing about himself here. I just think it's awesome that he throws a humble brag in there. Like she ran, this is what he said. She ran to get to Peter and the one that Jesus, his favorite, the one, the beloved, the one Jesus really loved. Listen, I love that God let him put that in there. He's bragging about how loved he is. It's like if you told me, what are you doing for lunch today? I said, well, I'm going to let you know I'm going out with, there's a group gathering. It's going to be Joe and it's going to be Mike and Jesus's beloved will be at Red Robin at 2:30. I love it. And so she ran She said, they've taken our Lord out of the tomb and we don't know where they put him. So Peter and the other disciple started to the tomb. But I want you to notice how they started. Both were running. Right here they entered the Easter morning 1,000 meter race, which is about how far it is from where they were locked up and hiding to the tomb that sealed Jesus momentarily. And John wants us to know how this race played out. He gives us the details. He says, but the other disciple, talking about himself, outran Peter. I love John. He wants all of the world to know for all of eternity in God's canonized word that will outlast everything else. He wants you and I to know I was faster than Peter. The other disciple, the beloved one, outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over, looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him, the slower one, and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple, talking about himself again, who had reached the tomb first, just so you don't forget. Also, apparently they had like some sibling rivalry going on here. He also went inside. He saw and he believed. Here we have two guys that are in a sprint running to an empty tomb. But what is amazing to me is that when they got there, Jesus was already alive. And the work had already been done. These boys ran as fast as they could. When they got the news, they didn't say, well, after we eat our breakfast, we'll try to make our way over there. We gotta do some stretching. I gotta find my Reeboks. They had no Reeboks. They looked at each other, and the competition to get there as soon as they could caused them to run with all their effort. Just imagine, there's no track. This is not a laid out paved road. They're running through the city of Jerusalem. They're cutting through corners, going through alleys. I wonder if John, if he knew a secret route that went under a corner of the building and over a fruit cart and around people, and he's looking at Peter and Peter's looking at him, and they run. But in all their efforts to get there first, Jesus still beat them to the punch. This is the good news of the gospel. I'm glad we didn't come here today to hear a message about how you have to run harder and run faster so you could get to God. The message of the gospel is that God already did all the movement, all the action, all the work. Before you even knew there was an empty tomb, the work was done. And the work was finished, and he rose from the dead. Before you even realized that you needed a Savior, and some of you are here today and you don't yet realize you need a Savior, but even at that, God has already moved on your behalf and done the most remarkable running that has ever been done. Since we're talking about remarkable running events, you got to talk to the most amazing event, and that's in Luke chapter 15. Jesus talked about when God ran. It's not a marathon of man. It's not a breaking record of individuals and humans. It's when God ran. Luke 15 is, of course, the story of the prodigal son. Even if you're not familiar with church, you've probably heard of that phrase, that term, the prodigal son, and probably have some sort of perspective of that. It's arguably one of, if not the most famous parable of all parables. Luke chapter 15, Jesus gives these parables, these stories to illustrate the kingdom of God. Theologians and scholars have referred to Luke 15 as the gospel within the gospels because he articulates and clearly illustrates for us the beauty of the gospel and God's heart towards lost people. Now, I know this isn't politically correct, and I realize this might offend some people today, but according to scripture, outside of Jesus, we're all lost. I don't care how good your GPS is. Outside of Christ, we're lost. In fact, when God looks down upon humanity, he doesn't see, he doesn't break us up into necessarily nations, not even really diversity segments. He looks and he sees two categories, those that are lost and those that have been found. Let me say it like this. He looks at those that are lost and those that were lost. And so in Luke 15, he shows us in these stories of the parable of the lost sheep, the lost coin, and the lost son compounded together to illustrate God's heart of how he comes running after you. Luke 15, the story of the prodigal son, this boy that Jesus says there's his father, has two sons, and the younger son comes to him. And Jesus is talking here to Jewish listeners. And he describes this story of a son that would come to his father and ask for his inheritance. You may read that and hear that and think that's no big deal. But it would be shocking and it would be disgusting to the listeners of Jesus' day. They would have sucked the air out of the room and gasped to hear that a son had the gall, nerve, and audacity to ask his father for his inheritance while he was still alive. Because that was to deny one's genealogy. It was to cut oneself off from the family line. It was essentially saying, Dad, I want you to die so I can get what's mine. It's saying, I'd rather do my life without you as my father in order so that I could have what I want. It's the heart of every human being. It's the root of all sin. It's pride. Listeners would be thinking to themselves, oh, that son has it coming to him. What an awful son. The Bible tells us that he goes to a far-off country. He leaves his family with his inheritance, and he squanders all of his resource. He spends it all. A famine hits the land. He finds himself at an all-time low. He loses all of his friends. They bounce. He loses all of his wealth. He's run dry. And he's so desperate that he gets hired by a pig farmer, and he's the pig slop boy. And again, when the Jews heard this, they would think, oh, that's the lowest of lows. He's working for a Gentile with unclean pigs. Jesus is setting the stage here as he's shocking his listeners. And in this moment of lowest of lows, the young man comes to himself and he begins to think, I gotta get back to my dad, because even the hired servants have it better off than living in the pig slop and in this filth. And he puts together this speech and says, I'm gonna go back and I'll ask for his forgiveness, and I'll convince him that I'm no longer worthy to be your son, but maybe you could hire me as a tradesman and I can pay off my debt and restore with paying off my debt, we could restore our broken relationship. Maybe there's a chance we can make this right if I work hard enough and do good enough. And he comes with this speech, and the Bible picks up in Luke 15 verse number 20, and it says this. Look at this. He got up and went to his father. He's headed back home, broke, busted, disgusted. But it says while he was still a long way off. I just want you to know today that you and I, our best efforts to do good and be right with God, we're still a long way off. We still come up short of being right with God and getting to God in and of ourselves. I don't care how fast you run, he's still a long way off. But look at this, his father saw him. I think he was waiting and longing with eager anticipation that this might be the day my boy comes home. He saw him and his heart was filled with compassion. Look at this. He ran to his son. He threw his arms around him and kissed him. First of all, I'm stunned that when he saw him a long way off, he wasn't filled with contempt, but he was filled with compassion. And you need to know this, that this is exactly how God sees you. No matter where you've been, no matter what you've done, no matter what you've come through, no matter what you carried in today, you might have proverbial pig slop all over your life. He sees you with compassion. He You say, well, you don't know what I've done. You don't know my, you're right. But whatever mess and dysfunction you come here with today, you need to know it breaks the heart of God for you. He loves you. And he moves towards you. And again, when they heard this, that the father would run, they thought, this is absurd. Because this was one of the craziest things Jesus could ever say, that a father would run. You need to understand that in this culture, no patriarch in this position would ever run in public. It was disgraceful. It was not just disrespectful, it was shameful for a grown man. He was supposed to be stoic and to run. They didn't have joggers. They didn't have some really too awkwardly short shorts like you have. They had robes. Have you ever tried running in a choir robe? It was disgraceful because a man running would have to expose his legs, and that was completely shameful. But I love what this father does the moment he sees his son crest the horizon. He says, I don't care what the village says. I don't care what the community thinks. I don't care what my neighbors think. They're going to see some of my ankles today. They're going to see some of my calves. In fact, they might see some pasty white thigh action today. But I am going to get to my son. And he began to run towards his son. He said, I don't care what you think. I've got to get to my boy. And it begs the question, why? I've heard this story my whole life. My dad has preached it. I'm a pastor's kid. He's on the front row. He's preached it hundreds of times. I've preached it. But I've never asked the question, why? Why did he run? I thought he was just excited. I thought he just was longing for his son and wanted to hug him. And I'm sure that was part of it, but it was much deeper than that. I think the problem is we hear these kind of stories and we view them through the lens of a Western culture. And we tend to, at least I do, anybody else visualize this as a big farmland and the dad's out on the front porch and rolling hills and all the acreage, no neighbors, no city, no village, and he crests over the hill and he's making his way down the long, narrow lane through the gates at the end of the driveway towards the porch. Anybody else see it like that? It's because we're Westernized. But that's not how it was. Recently, I've been reading from a great theologian and scholar by the name of Dr. Kenneth Bailey. He's a New Testament scholar who's written extensively on seeing the Gospels and the parables of Jesus through the lens of Middle Eastern eyes to bring context. And much of what we read, we can go right over without the true depth that would have been at the forefront of their thinking and understanding. And Dr. Kenneth Bailey spends time writing about how in the Talmud, the Jewish law, there was a ceremony called kizaza. And it was a judgment ceremony, a method of punishing a Jewish boy who either, one, lost his inheritance to Gentiles or married a Gentile woman. It was a big deal. Well, we know that this guy, he did the first one. He lost his money to Gentiles, his inheritance. And were that to happen, the boy, if he decided to return home, would have to come to the village and at the gates of the city face kizaza. It was a ceremony where the elders would gather around the village, would decide if he was welcomed home or cut off. That's what kizaza means, to be cut off. It's interesting that the mother was allowed to go to this ceremony to plead mercy for her son, but the father wasn't able to go. He would have to stay home because the father, in this culture, his blessing would be able to trump any decision of the elders. He had to stay home. And so this would be at the forefront of this young man's mind coming home, and the father too. And once he pleaded his case, if he was still found guilty, they would symbolically take a clay pot and throw it at his feet, and it would be smashed in front of him, and they would say, so-and-so is kizaza. He's cut off. It's the equivalent of how the Amish would shun and ostracize you from their society. No trade, no selling, no buying, no employment. You are on your own, and nobody's going to help you. You are cut off forever. And though Jesus doesn't explicitly mention this ceremony, all the Jews that were listening this day would be thinking, oh, he has a clay pot coming with his name on it. He's about to get cut off. And the dad knew this too. And I would suggest to you that the dad wasn't just excited to see his son, but he was watching for his son's return. And this is why he went running, because that dad knew he had to get to his boy before his boy got to Kazaza. That dad knew that he had to get to his son before his son got to the gates of the city. And this is why he sprints to his son while he's still a great way off, running to him, kissing him, embracing him, and says, get the robe, put it on him. Get a ring and put it on his finger. Get shoes on his feet, because he knew he had to get to his son and trump the clay pot of being cut off. I just imagine this. This would be, again, shocking. How could he do that? Clothing him and restoring him and reconciling him and interrupting his stupid speech of trying to earn back his right standing. And with a robe on and shoes on and a ring on and his dad's arm around his shoulder, they walk back towards the city through the gates as all the villagers are there, all the community ready to cut him off, and they are silenced. I just imagine the father saying, nope, he's with me. He's with me. I trumpet. He's with me. You got to be quiet, silent. Nope, you put that clay pot away. And they walk back to a dance floor and a celebration, because my son was lost, but now he's found. He was dead, but he is alive. If you're not connecting the dots yet, this is the gospel of Jesus Christ. This is the good news. It is scandalous. It is shocking. It's not fair. That's why it's good news. Gospel is not you get what you deserve, but I give you what you don't deserve. Now, you need to understand this. You might be thinking like, well, wait a minute. God just like sweeping sin under the rug? Is he ignoring consequences? And I've got kids that are crazy. I can't ignore their consequences. No. God is a completely just God. He is all justice, and at the same time, he is all love. In fact, when you fast forward to Good Friday, where Jesus is hanging on the cross, Good Friday, just so you know, it's good for us. It was really bad for Jesus. But at the cross, there was a cataclysmic collision of God's justice and mercy on display. Thank God for the cross. It's not just a symbol of God's love, it's a symbol of his justice. He doesn't just ignore sin. What kind of judge, if someone criminalized you, robbed from you, wronged you, hurt you, and a judge failed to convict them and said, it's no big deal, let them off, you would think that judge is not just. So God has to justly deal with the sin problem, for the wages of sin is death. Somebody's got to die. And at the cross, we see clearly God's justice on display and God's love on display. You need to understand that at the cross of Calvary, Jesus was cut off. He received the ceremony of Kazaza. Here's where God the Father threw the clay pot at his feet, and it was smashed. It makes sense why Jesus, in that moment, as he carried the sins of the world, do you realize every sin that was ever done and ever will be done was concentrated upon the shoulders of Jesus in that moment? There was so much concentration of sin in one place that the earth began to tremor. The universe couldn't handle it. The sun was darkened for hours and God turned his face. This is where Jesus on the cross, he cried out, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, my God, why have you forsaken me? He was cut off. I would suggest and propose this was the greatest turmoil for our Savior on the cross. The greatest pain wasn't the physical pain, but experiencing something he had never experienced before. a disconnect relationally in those moments with the Father. You need to understand Jesus was cut off so you and I could be welcomed home. He received our punishment so you and I could receive a party in heaven. 2 Corinthians 5:21 says, He, Jesus, who knew no sin, He was perfect. But He who knew no sin, He became sin at the cross, so you and I might become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. You know what that means? Martin Luther calls this the great exchange. There was, the theological, sophisticated word is that He imputed His righteousness to you. You imputed or credited your sin to Him. In other words, He put His righteousness to cover up your pig slop. And He put the pig slop on Him. And He was cut off so you could be welcomed home. This is the good news of Jesus. This is why we celebrate. This is the gospel. And then the Father, just quickly, I know you got Cadbury eggs to eat today. Praise God. The Father says, prepare or kill the fatted calf. Get that fatted calf. Again, we don't live in an agrarian society. Unless you're a rancher, this just doesn't connect. If you buy your meat at Costco, it's like, what's the big deal? But a fatted calf in the culture of Jesus' day meant you were anticipating a great celebration. Jesus is saying the Father has been getting ready. He was interceding, longing, and preparing for His. He said, I know my Son is going to come home. And the moment He steps into this house, get that calf ready because it's happening quick. Get it some extra oats. Get it some creatine, whatever you need to do. Beef that thing up. Some of you here today, you need to know that God has been getting the fatted calf ready for you. The calf has been getting ready for you. For a celebration, you say, what does that mean? Revelation tells us that our Savior, Jesus Christ, was the Lamb that was slain before the foundations of the world. Long before time began, the cross was in God's heart and plan. Calvary was not an accident. It wasn't second option. It wasn't the working of hell. It was in the heart of God for Jesus, what Hebrews would say, to die once and for all. For the sins of humanity. He's getting the calf ready so He can celebrate. I'm telling you, God has moved first. So on the day you decide to come home, you might be like John and you get there first. You might be a little slow like Peter and you're not there yet. But when you do get there and you realize what you are doing is not working and you need a Savior, God is not caught off guard. He's not scrounging through the cabinets trying to get a meal ready and a way ready. He has been preparing and anticipating for your return home. Let me read these final verses before I pray today. Romans 5 verse 8 tells us this. But God, look at this. But God demonstrates His own love toward us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. You go ahead and run as fast as you can. It doesn't matter. God has ran first. I like how the Message paraphrases this. Look at this with me. Christ arrives right on time to make this happen. He didn't and doesn't wait for us to get ready. How many are grateful for that? He presented Himself for this sacrificial death when we were far too weak and far too rebellious to do anything to get ourselves ready. He's moved first. He loved you first. Sabrina and I, we are pretty competitive. We would have ran. I would have beat her. I just so you know, I would. Not physically beat her. I don't do that. That's not good. I'm like beat her in the race, just to clarify. She could probably beat me up, just saying. So we were like all the time. She'll say, I love you. I say, I love you first. She's like, no, you didn't. I said, well, I said it first. She's like, well, I thought it first. Well, I felt it first. Like, how far back can we go? All of my kids, I got four kids from 21 to 11. Their whole life I've told him I love him, but I throw in there, I love you first. My son will come up to me, he's 11. He's like, I love you, Dad. I'm like, well, I loved you first. He's like, oh, you got me. How do I beat that? We adopted Sean when he was 4 years old, and love filled my heart the moment I saw that little Polaroid picture of him. He had no idea who we were. We were strangers. But I loved him first. Before he knew he needed a family, before he knew he needed to, before he even realized where he was, I loved him first. My daughters, I remember every moment they put jelly on the belly and the ultrasound popped up. I've never felt what I felt in that moment as I saw the heartbeat and what looked like a little shrimp or alien. They were bizarre looking, but I love that little jelly bean. I love you first. God's saying, I loved you first. I got there first. Here's why this matters in closing. Because there's going to be a day where this is not just a story about antiquity, it's a story all about your eternity. You need to know this. Hebrews is clear that there is a day where all of us will breathe our last breath. I hope yours is far from now, but the reality is odds hover right around 100%. We're all going to die. Have you considered appointed unto man to die once, and after that, the judgment? What does that mean? That when we leave this life, we will stand before God Almighty, the creator of the cosmos, and give account for our life. And there are two destinations, heaven or hell, welcome home or cut off forever. But you decide now. This is why the good news is so good. Because it's the message of God running to you, Jesus running to you and to me. While we are a great way off, he has tucked up his robe. He's exposed and embarrassed and humiliated himself at the cross to get to you. The message of the cross is foolishness to those that are perishing, but to those of us who are being saved, it is the power of God unto salvation. He is chasing after you. Why? I don't know what you think of the gates of heaven. Some of you bought in this lie that's going to be like, well, there are too many jokes. Like, there was a Raider fan and Charger fan, and they were up there, and Peter came, and you can't sweet talk your way into the gates of heaven. Your speech is not going to cut it. You can't bargain with God and say, well, I'll pay you back to be right. It's too late. The only way you make it through those gates is the same way this son made it through his gates. Jesus runs to you. And puts his robe of righteousness over you. And puts shoes that lift you up and secure your footing and give you peace. And puts a ring of authority on your finger. And puts his arm around you and walks you through. And says, no, nope, nope, there's no judgment on this one. He's with me. She's with me. She's covered. She's got the ring on. She's got the shoes on her feet. She's got the robe. Back up, back, but he's coming through. No judgment on this one, and you are welcomed home into God's eternal village. Oh, what a Savior! Yeah, isn't he wonderful? He is. I invite you right where you are today to join me and stand to your feet, would you, in these final concluding moments. And I want to lead you in a prayer of faith and confession. And I know in this room today, there are many, many. God's been chasing you. He's been chasing you. We've been praying for you. Those of you that don't know God, you've been on the run. Someone that came and your friend invited you. They set you up. This is all set up for this moment right here. God has been preparing this moment we just read from Revelation since the beginning of time. He has been waiting for this moment to come crashing into your life with his grace and his mercy. I'm going to invite you just where you are to close your eyes and bow your heads this morning. There are some of you in this place today and your heart feels like it's about to burst. know what that is? That's the Holy Spirit of God knocking on your heart, saying, will you let me in? Will you let me do that work in your life that loud, obnoxious preacher just talked about? Your heart feel warm today? In Luke 24, the disciples that did not recognize Jesus after the resurrection walked with him, heard the word. The moment their eyes were open, he vanished, and they said to one another, haven't our hearts been warmed because he was here? He was preaching the word, and that's why your heart's feeling it right now. Right where you're standing today, I'm going to invite you to pray a faith-filled prayer of confession. The Bible says whoever confesses Jesus as Lord will be saved. If you confess him as Lord, believe in your heart that he lives forevermore. That's how important the resurrection is. You got to believe that he is alive. You will be saved. Not maybe, not might be, not possibly. You will be saved. Come on, God's left his porch running after you. He's running. He's running. He's about to come wrap his arms around you. Will you receive what he did and who he is? Nobody's looking around. This is, forget about the person on your left or your right. But if that's you and you say, Matthew, I'm not right with God. I know I'm not close with God. And in fact, I know he's not pleased with me. Or you have all these ideas and conceptions about who he is. Maybe you feel like he has contempt towards you. No, he has compassion towards you. You don't have to take the wrath of God. That got absorbed at the cross of Calvary. This morning, I would love to lead you in a prayer. Even if you don't know what to say, I'll help you with the words. But you just mean this from your heart today. But if that's you, I'm going to just ask you to boldly, on the count of three, put your hands in the air, and we're going to pray. Because for many in this place today, today is the day of salvation. By the way, we do this every weekend at Grace. People get saved. People come home. Heaven's leaning over right now, ready to cheer and celebrate decisions that are going to be made in these next few moments. If that's you, I don't care where you're seated. I don't care if you're at the top, at the bottom, in the front, in the back. I don't care if you're in the lobby. If that's you right now and you know that God's tugging on your heart and you're ready to surrender to his lordship, and you need to be saved and want to be saved, I'm going to ask you on the count of three to put your hand in the air. One, today is the day of salvation. Two, I'm going to give my life to Jesus. Three, put your hand in the air. Would you do that right where you are? Come on, lift them up high. Lift them up high. Lift them up high all over the place today. I see you up there in the balcony. Yeah, you can celebrate that today, Grace. If your hand's not up, just hold it up for a minute. I just want to make eye contact with every single person I can. I'm proud of you. Yes, yes. God is writing your story. All across this place, I see hands. I can't see your face up there, but I can see your hands all over the balcony today. Let's pray this out loud, every voice together. Say, Jesus, I confess that you are Lord. I believe you live forevermore. And I realize I need you. I cannot save myself. So would you rescue me from sin? Bring me home, I pray. Put a robe on me. Shoes on my feet, a ring on my finger. I do not want to be cut off, so I put my faith in you today. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's take these next 30 seconds. Can we just make this our prayer? Lift up our voices. Oh, what a Savior!
Oh, what a Savior! Isn't He?
Forevermore. Bow down before Him, for He is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah,
Christ is real.
grace and your mercy, Lord, we put our focus on you today. Thank you for everything you've done to get in front of us. In Jesus' mighty name, all the runners said amen. Amen. Hey, thank you for joining us, all of our guests. We're so glad you were here today. Hope to see you again. If you're looking for a good church, come hang out with us. We look forward to getting to know you. If you prayed that prayer for the first time, let us know. We got some Bibles here for you. Our team will be up front. We have some great next steps available for you. God bless you. Have a great rest of your rainy Easter Sunday.